Hi, this is Mario Aquino. I'm one of the organizers for the Strange Loop Conference, and this is another episode of Strange Loop Chats. With me today is Paula Gearon. She is an engineer at Cisco in the Threat Grid Group, and we're going to be talking today about an open source database that Paula maintains that's called Asami. Before I get to that, I'd like to mention that Strange Loop this year is going to start on Thursday, September 30th, which is going to be our workshop day. And the conference proper is going to start on Friday, October 1st and run 2 days, the 1st and 2nd of October. If you'd like to find out more, you can visit thestrangeloop.com for details about tickets and the schedule. So with that out of the way, let me introduce Paula. Paula, thank you for sitting with me for this interview. Welcome.
Thanks, Mario.
So I wanted to talk to you today about Asami. What can you tell me about Asami? What is it?
It's a graph database. It started life as an in-memory graph database, but recently we developed it into something which also stores persistently on disk and looking at different types of provisioning for being able to store it in lots of different ways and locations as well. But yeah, it's a graph database written entirely in Clojure, and it is there to provide graph services for Clojure developers who want to use data in that way.
So can you describe what exactly is a graph database?
A graph database represents graph data, where a graph in the mathematical sense is essentially like a network. It looks like a whole series of nodes with lines connecting. So we typically think of these things as each node, each dot representing some kind of resource. And then the line in between will have a label, and it will be typically in a direction. So if I have a resource which represents a person, I can have lines then which go off to the different attributes of a person, like their name, their address, and things like that. And I can also have lines which connect that person's node to nodes which represent other people, either as friends or their manager or neighbors. Then we can have nodes which represent companies or cities or anything at all, really. And so it's a very flexible arrangement for data, and it provides this really consistent way of looking at any kind of data at all.
So it's a database that allows you to establish relationships between entities that you store in it, and it's written in Clojure. Is it a database that also works in Clojure Script?
Originally, I wrote it as Clojure, and then I was asked, can you move it up into the browser? So we did. Our principal use for it at Cisco at the moment is in the browser, and it's operating as a memory model for an important product that we've got, which has a lot of deployment internationally now. But it also works on a machine running on the JVM. And it's in that state at the moment that we've been working a lot with the persistence model, how this can be stored to disk effectively.
So the name Asami, can you tell me what is that?
Sort of an internal joke. 5 years ago, we started with this project, which was the Internet Resource Orchestration Hub, Iroh. Well, Uncle Iroh was a character in the TV series Avatar: The Last Airbender. And our manager at the time really enjoyed that show, and he started naming all of these projects after Avatar characters. I think Iroh running in the cloud was called Tenzin, which is from the Avatar spin-off. Well, Asami is a character from Korra as well. Originally, I had written a rules engine which used Asami, and that engine was called Naga, again, another character from the same TV show.
So what would you say distinguishes Asami from other graph databases?
Well, every graph database has its own pros and cons. I mean, originally Asami was simply an in-memory model for Naga because we wanted something where we wouldn't need an external dependency. I was building it around Datomic. And because we were going to be doing this thing in-house, I was asked, well, could you maybe do something that doesn't involve a commercial system? That way this whole thing could be open source. And if I had thought I was going to build an entire graph database, I'd have said no. We weren't aware of DataScript at that point. I built the basic functionality that was required because that's all we needed. But over time, as Naga needed to do more things with rules, we introduced more and more features And finally, I realized that this storage system had gained a life of its own, and we broke it out into its own project. And now it's become dominant work for me, where the whole query engine, the query language, everything's been expanding. And, you know, from that point, it then I was asked to move it into the browser. And so it became a cross-platform project between the JVM and ClojureScript in the browser. So yeah, running our own project that way did give us the flexibility to make that move. And it's also given us the opportunity to introduce new features as we wanted them. Things like aggregates, which, you know, Datomic already had, but also things like graph analytics. So we can do queries on transitive attributes, or we can find subgraphs where if you've got two distinct disconnected graphs, we can identify those. And, you know, different sorts of graph algorithms like this are all things we've been able to implement internally so that they're really optimized for the data structures.
You mentioned that Asami has querying capability. You know, you can't really have a database without a querying capability. What would you say inspired the way that the querying works in Asami?
Two things. Firstly, Datomic. So Datomic has specified a graph querying language, which is written in using the data structures that make up Clojure itself. So essentially Eden. And that's been really useful to leverage because we can read it for free. We don't have to worry about parsing. But the other thing that it's based on is Sparkle. So 20 years ago, I was a lead architect on another graph database called Muldara. And that was written entirely for the JVM. Back then, we developed our own query language. And over time, it became clear that IDF data required its own query language, a standard. And so a committee was formed, which was the Sparkle committee. I wasn't on that one. I contributed to it. But then some years later, as new features were required, the second Sparkle committee was put together. And I was on that. I was one of the editors for the documents. So there's a whole lot of semantics in Sparkle, which differ a little bit from Datomic. And because of some of the architectural decisions that we've made in Asami, it made much more sense to go often with the Sparkle semantics over the Datomic semantics.
So the syntax is some kind of a union between Datomic query language and Sparkle semantics.
Mostly in the edge cases. In most queries, you're going to find that you can copy paste something from Datomic or DataScript and just use it on Asami and it'll just work. But there are a few things where you're going to find, like doing a not operation or certain kinds of unions, where the edge cases lean more towards the Sparkle interpretation of the world rather than Datomic.
So what would you say is sort of an ideal use case for Asami? Where does it really shine?
When you've got a lot of disparate data, so a lot of data that you're getting from different places where you want to find linkages between the data, where you want to take data which may have come from tables, but when you put it together, you would otherwise require dozens and dozens of tables with lots of foreign joins and things like that. If it were in the relational world, when you're bringing a lot of data together like that, then graph databases in general are very useful that way. Asami has been designed internally to be optimized around querying. It's optimized around querying, but, you know, at the expense of taking a little longer to load data up. So if you're going to be doing, as someone mentioned yesterday, 30 transactions a second, then Asami is going to be slower then. But if you're only, you know, if you're loading your data up once or every few minutes, then and querying it a lot and analyzing it a lot, then Asami is really going to shine. And, you know, Asami can still handle a lot of transactions, but there are other systems which are going to be optimized more around that. And yet they won't necessarily answer queries as quickly.
You're actively maintaining Asami. What is it that you're sort of focusing on right now in terms of the feature set that you're trying to bring to it?
I'm focusing on what my colleagues at work say they need. So when someone says, like, can I do this? Or doesn't that, you know, does this work the way I think it should? Then that's my main priority. But when people aren't asking me for that, I've been working on storage with just coming up to a 2.0 release, which is where the durable storage, so not entirely confined to memory anymore, is finally going to be released. There's more architecture to happen there. There are certain elements of it which I'm really happy with, and other things which I know could use more effective data structures. But it works really well at the moment, and I'm looking forward to just getting that out the door. And then we've got more layers of indexing and features that we want to have there. You know, there's trade-offs at every level, but we're looking at introducing some of these new features to meet the requirements that my colleagues have, frankly, to, you know, to speed up certain things and to make data available easily in some ways where it may not be so easy to get to it at the moment.
So in terms of durable storage, what is the sort of goal for being able to persist the database, I guess, in a format that has already some amount of identity data in it? Is it for replication? Is it for quick loading, like a database that already, you know, contains?
So everything's immutable internally, and I have a whole lot of documentation around this on the project website. And it, you know, internally, Closure itself uses these kinds of data structures. The last database I was working on, Mulgara, it also used that kind of data structure. And because we have a whole lot of immutable data structures, so things which never change, we only add to the storage, this means that replication is really quite easy. We can just take things knowing that they're never going to change again. We can then spread it across a cluster, because again, we know that once something's been written, it never changes. And this gives us a whole lot of, you know, advantages almost for free. One of the things which, you know, when Datomic came out, it seemed like a revelation, was that you could go back in time and look at how things used to be. Ironically, Mulgara always had that kind of data structure, but we built it 20 years ago when disk wasn't as cheap as it is now. And consequently, we needed to clean up any data that was old that we weren't using anymore. And, you know, for performance reasons over time, I eventually ripped that code out, because all that bookkeeping and cleanliness was, you know, had a cost for the database. And so I was just leaving these things hanging around. And then when Datomic came out and we were shown that we had this rich history of what all the data had looked like getting to this point, I realized at that point that Mulgara already had that, but it just hadn't exposed it to the user. Asami has that now, and it's been inspired by Mulgara's structures. I've modernized them. I updated things over the years as I came up with better ideas as to how these things should be built. And yeah, so a number of the features which Datomic has, which make it like very different to other sorts of databases before it, are also present in Asami. And, you know, I kind of, while I'm not aiming to do exactly the same sorts of things as Datomic, at the same time, it has led me to certain features, thinking, you know, I kind of like that. I'd like to have that in my system as well. And sure enough, people, you know, for the things I haven't finished doing, people come to me and say, when do we get this feature? So I know that it's wanted.
Community-wise, there are, I guess, groups outside of Cisco that are either using or experimenting with Asami?
So a friend of mine started a channel on the Clojurian Slack, and a number of people have been joining it. I've seen people saying that they're assessing Asami for their workplace. I've had feedback. I've had pull requests to, you know, to create new features or to expand on things. And so there seems to be a lot of interest around what I'm doing, which is really quite nice. And, you know, I want to be responsive to the people who are using it as well. Yeah, I mean, this was kind of a hobby of mine that I was doing on the side. And I showed my manager years ago and he said, this looks great, do it for work. And, you know, so I'm in a really privileged position that I get to do something which I was finding interesting for my job. And, you know, I want to be as responsive to people as I can be so that I get to keep doing this job.
So for folks interested in checking out Asami for themselves, where should they go?
To GitHub. It's under ThreatGrid Asami. It's an open source project. All the documentation's online. I do work hard to try to make sure that everything is really well documented. A lot of times people ask me for how things are working and I'm able to point them at docs. and that's really paid for itself. So hopefully if you need to find things, then you can go there. Otherwise, you can always go to the Clergerian Slack and look for Asami. If you ask questions, I do try to be as responsive as I can be.
All right. Well, Paula, I want to thank you for sitting down for this Strange Loop chat. And for folks who are watching, if you would like to find out more about Asami, there will be links when this video is posted to where you can read about it on GitHub. Well, Paula, thanks again. It's been great talking to you.
You're welcome. Thanks, Brian.